Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
He is risen. He is risen indeed. It's good to be with you as we gather together on Easter morning. And thank you for joining us this morning as we worship the Lord in spirit and truth. I'm Michael Bingham. I'm the pastor here at St. Mark Church. And in the name of the risen Christ, I want to welcome all of you to our service this morning. I have a few announcements I would like to call your attention to. For those of you who helped out with the egg hunt, I want to give you a big thank you. We had an awesome event yesterday, so a lot of you helped out both behind the scenes and also in public ways, and we appreciate that. So thank you again for your assistance. Also, Good Neighbors will meet this Wednesday at noon, so if you'd like to join us, it's just a group of people who want to be gathered together and eat some good food together and have some good fellowship. So all you got to do is show up with an appetite, and we'd love to have you. So that's the Good Neighbors at Wednesday at noon. And also, the fifth Sunday will be 2 weeks from today. That's April the 30th. And so after the 11 o'clock service, after this service, we'll have a dinner together. So if you'd bring sides and desserts, we'd love to have you. The church will be providing the meat, and we have a good time at those. So we invite you to join us on that fifth Sunday. Now, I've got a couple of announcements about the Relay for Life. This is a fundraiser for the American Cancer Society. And many in our church have had their lives touched by cancer. And so this church has a long history of supporting this event. So I invite you in two ways. First of all, you can join the St. Mark team. There's some information in your bulletin. You'll see it on the screen behind me about how you can plug into that and join the St. Mark United Methodist team for the Relay for Life. But also, you can buy luminaries. And so luminaries are used during the opening ceremonies. They're to give encouragement to caregivers of those with cancer. They're in memory of loved ones who have lost the battle with cancer, and they're for survivors and those battling cancer now, so they give a lot of hope. And all the funds raised here through these efforts will go to the American Cancer Society, so I encourage you to give to that cause. Also, on May the 7th, our women's group is raising money through a chicken salad box lunch, and so if you'd like to purchase one of those are $8. And then I'd like to call your attention to our Making the Shift weekend, which will be May 19th and 20th. If you're aware at all of what's going on in our culture, you're aware of the changes that are ongoing and many things happening in our culture. As we meet today on Easter, since January the 1st, over 1,100 churches in the United States have closed their doors permanently. And so this is an ongoing trend and an rapidly increasing trend, and so we're going to talk about that honestly and how we can adapt to that. That's what the shift is. So that's May 19th and 20th. I hope you'll put that on your calendar and join us for that, and so it'll be very good indeed if you will do so. And now we want to celebrate life and covenant. Are there birthdays or anniversaries you'd like to celebrate at this time? All right, seeing none, I hope you buckle your chin strap, because here we go.
Hey, welcome to our church. It's Easter, and for us, that's a really big deal. Here's why. In our church, we believe that a guy named Jesus really walked the earth. We believe Pilate had him beaten, and we believe Peter denied him. At our church, we believe that Jesus was nailed to beams of wood. We believe that he shed real blood, cried real tears, and felt real pain. We believe the sky grew dark and the earth shook. And we believe that after six excruciating hours, Christ's agony came to a crashing halt when he breathed his last breath. We also believe the story didn't end there. In our church, we believe with every ounce of our being that Jesus walked out of the tomb alive on Sunday morning. Please don't ask us to shy away from that core conviction, because it lies at the very center of our faith. And we invite you to check it out for yourself. In our church, we're not just going to leave the story there. We're not going to place it on a dusty doctrinal bookshelf in some church basement. At our church, we're going to learn to live today in full response to the empty tomb. And make no mistake about it, there is abundant life to be had right now for every person in this room. And it's all because 2,000 years ago, God took on human flesh, he lived, and he died, and then he lived again. And today, we are celebrating that event and the life it offers us. It's Easter. He is risen. Welcome to our church.
This time, let's stand and join together in our Easter call to worship. Joshua, we should have a slide about this. we have difficulties. Ah, there it is. He is risen. Soar we now where Christ has led, following our exalted head.
May by him, like thy kingdom rise, ours the cross, the greater the skies.
He who testifies to these things says, yes, I am coming soon.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
Let us pray. O God, you gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross for our redemption. And by his glorious resurrection, you delivered us from the power of our enemy. Grant that we may die to sin daily, so that we may live forevermore with him in the joy of his resurrection. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. All right, our hymn, Christ the Lord is Risen Today. Let's sing verses 1 through 4. was good, wasn't it? All right, so as we get ready to do our affirmation of faith, I want to take a moment to talk about the Nicene Creed. In the 4th century, there was a great deal of controversy about how it is that we talk about Jesus and who he is and who he claimed to be. And so during the midst of that controversy, they gathered together, all the bishops of the church, and they talked about that, and they came up with this creed in 325, which was amended slightly about 60 years later. And so we have this, the most ancient of creed, and the only creed in Christendom ever voted on by the entire church. It was not a close election. It was unanimous. So let us unite in this historic confession of the Christian faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in the one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated. Will the children come forward for children's time? Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, yes. So many of you are wearing nice new clothes today. That's a wonderful thing. I kind of want to talk about that because today's a special day. It's Easter, and we're celebrating today when Jesus Christ, he had died, and he came back, and that's called the resurrection. And one of the ways we do that is something we kind of take for granted sometimes, except on a special day like this, but Sunday in and Sunday out, almost every Sunday of the year, we have flowers in our sanctuary. And y'all are wearing your new clothes, and that's what flowers do. They represent for us the newness, and they represent life. And that's why they're here. Now, I have a feeling by the time you got here, you couldn't do it anymore because the doors had been open for a while. But this morning early, when there weren't that many of us here, and we came in, we opened the doors up at the church real early this morning, you could actually smell, because we have so many pretty lilies in here, you could smell them. So not only could you see, but you could actually smell the newness, and it was a really cool thing. They smelled beautiful. Somebody said to me this morning, I had no idea that lilies smelled that good until I came into church this morning, and that's what it was like. So you might want to smell them before you leave. Right outside the door of the church as you leave, there's a big cross there, and you'll see some flowers on it, and you can take some flowers after church, not during, and you can take them out there and put them on that cross, and people take their pictures there. If you want to do that, it'd be great. But that the flowers on that cross also represent new life, which is what Jesus came to bring us. So the resurrection today on Easter, as we celebrate this most sacred day of the year for us, we remember what Jesus did, and the flowers remind us of that. So let's pray. Y'all pray after me. Dear God, thank you for sending Jesus to die for us. Help us to live for him. In his name, amen. Thank you, boys and girls. Let's come now to our time of prayer together. I have several prayer requests I'd like to lift before you. Amy Alexander's father has been in the hospital, and so we pray for him and his family. Also, Timmy Linker has been in the hospital since Thursday. He had a couple of stents put in for his heart. They were looking at possibly doing a pacemaker. I think at this time they've elected not to do so, and he's expected to go home today. So let's remember Timmy and his family. Nancy Strickland also had to go to the emergency room yesterday. She has influenza and is dehydrated. So for those of you who need a flu shot, enough said. Alicia Duval is a friend of Stacy Sheely, and she's having brain surgery tomorrow to remove a tumor. It's very serious. And also Gwinnett, who's with us this morning. She's recovering from a fall. Gwinnett, it's good to see you this morning. And so let's remember also the persecuted church. We're gathered here this morning on Easter and freedom and comfort and security. But an independent report came out recently that says that Christians are the most persecuted religious group in the world right now. And over 100 Christians were martyred on Palm Sunday in attacks in Egypt. So while we're gathered here in safety, the persecuted church is not always able. In some places like North Korea, it's the nation itself which puts Christians to death. But also almost one-third of all the Christians who were killed in the past year were killed by ISIS. So let's remember those who are unable to worship in freedom or security. And at this time, let's go to the Lord. Gracious God, we give thanks to you for the safety that we enjoy here at St. Mark United Methodist Church in Charleston, South Carolina. And we are mindful, O Lord, of our brothers and sisters who on this most sacred day are not able to worship freely or who are unable to worship in freedom and security, Lord. And we pray for them. We pray for our persecuted brothers and sisters. We remember, O Lord, those whose names we've lifted before you aloud this morning. And we pray, O Lord, for those whose names we've held close in our heart. We pray especially this morning for those who grieve, for those who mourn, for those who feel a feeling of despair or lack hope in their lives, who feel anxiety, O Lord. And we pray that in the resurrection of Christ our Lord, they might find hope and peace. And we pray all of this in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, let us offer unto God his tithes and our offerings.
There is a manger far away.
Almighty God, we give thanks to you for all with which you've blessed us. Receive now these your tithes and offerings and bless them to do your work in the world. In the name of the risen Christ we pray. Amen. Our hymn of preparation is Alleluia, Alleluia. Please be seated.
Like most kids, I learned about Easter at Sunday school. Although it was never very tangible to me, I guess I kind of put it in the same category as my grandfather's old war stories. I knew they happened, but their existence to me personally lived only on paper or old movies. It never seemed quite real. As I got to my teens, I considered myself a Christian. And every year when Easter rolled around, we'd gather the family together and go see the church's Easter production. But that's as deep as it ever got. Getting older, there comes a point when life just hits the on switch. I remember this happening pretty quickly right out of college. And getting married young was a hard thing to do. Of course, I love my wife, but there were some struggles. Those struggles grew into frustrations. Eventually, those frustrations grew into disappointments. It was tough. And having an unplanned child didn't make it easier. I started to experience anxieties that I never knew existed. Add in the mortgage, taxes, 2 car payments. I just didn't have time to feel insecure anymore. The weight of life has been unbearable at times. The pull from temptations just gets stronger and stronger. I might look composed, but the truth is, I'm afraid. Alone. I feel as though I'm the only one out there with these kind of issues. Most Christians I know, they seem to have it all together. Why can't I? But here's the amazing thing about Easter. Christ's crucifixion and resurrection is everything I need. The absolute beauty in it is its simplicity. His acts weren't a spectacle. They were sacrifice. A sacrifice for me. Easter is not just a holiday. It's a celebration of the life-changing power that exists because of God and His love for us. Purpose, freedom, peace, joy, hope. All these things Jesus intended for me. He made that sacrifice on the cross. All my failures, my anxieties, my sins and insecurities, they're all laid to rest. Christ's actions not only saved me, they completed me. He died for me. And He lives for me.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination as printed in the bulletin. Lord, open our minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with transforming joy what you say to us today. Amen. Today I am reading from John chapter 20, verses 19 through 31. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious God, we have heard this your word about your risen Son and his appearance to the 12. Help us, Lord, to be like them, to see and to believe and to go forth from this place eager to share this good news. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Peace be with you.
And also with you.
See, that's a part of our life together, that I can say that as a leader in this worship space, and we are sort of used to that, and you're able to respond to me where we share this peace. This is the word that the Lord shared with his apostles when he appeared to them. And so I want you to write that down this morning on your insert, if you would, please, in that first blank. Peace be with you and also with you. This kind of phrase that Jesus is standing there amidst his disciples. Now, it's not a rebuke to them for their lack of believing. It's simply to calm them because they are terrified, they are nervous, they have a lot of anxiety. And frankly, when you see a dead person standing in your midst, you would be terrified as well. And so when the risen Christ comes and stands with them, the first thing he says to them each and every time is peace. Or do not be afraid, some words like that where he assures them. So we say this to one another to remind ourselves of this peace of salvation that is ours. And this is a peace that Strong's Concordance says, and I'm quoting here, "The tranquil state of a soul assured of its salvation through Christ, and so fearing nothing from God and content with its earthly lot. Now that sounds good to me. I don't know about you, but this peace that transcends believing, this peace that comes into us. And so you may feel anxiety in your life right now, and this sermon here today is an invitation to feel this peace. And so I say to you again, peace be with you. Thank you for that. As we share the peace of the risen Christ with one another, this peace that goes between you and me and amongst us through the power of the Holy Spirit. So Jesus appeared, the risen Christ. He had been dead. The disciples were in an upper room. They were scared to death. The doors were locked. They were afraid that they were next. And suddenly the risen Christ is there amongst them. And this occurred on the first Easter Sunday. But it just so happened that Didymus, Thomas, was not there with them. And so when he came back to them, they said, "Hey, we've seen the Lord." And you know, he said that famous proclamation, "Unless I see him, unless I place my hands in the wounds, I won't believe." And of course, you know what happened? We just read about it. A week later, the risen Christ is with them as they gather. And in that moment, then Thomas declares that he is Lord and God. And I want to say to you today that it is easy, if we can see Jesus, it's easy to believe. And I want you to write that down on your insert. If we can see Jesus, it's easy to believe. If we can just see Jesus, it's easy to believe. So much so that Jesus says to Thomas, "You saw and believed. How much more blessed are those who do not see and yet believe?" So it's really easy to see, to believe if we see. I keep wanting to mess that up. I apologize. If we can just see Jesus, it's easy to believe. Now, we enable others to believe when we are the image of Christ and we allow this image of Christ to shine through us. And our faithfulness, therefore, brings a living faith alive in others. And so that's why it's important for us as Christians, those of us who are followers of the way, to allow the Holy Spirit into our lives to remake us and remold us. That makes it easier for others to believe. But sometimes it's hard to believe, and sometimes it's hard to see Jesus. But we are called to be the image of Christ in the lives of others. There's a story, and this is kind of an old story. It's over a century old, but I believe it to be true, about a missionary who went on a mission journey to another country, in a jungle country amongst a primitive people, and he was there to bring the gospel to them. And a group of them felt threatened by his presence, and they decided that this missionary needed to die. And so they began to chase him, to murder him. And so he was running from them. And he had a good head start, but he could not get away from them, and they were relentless in their pursuit, and he was beginning to become exhausted. And he came to the realization that he was not going to be able to outrun them. And so in desperation, he began to look for a place to hide. And lo and behold, he saw a cave, and he darted into the cave to hide. And as soon as he was in the cave, he recognized that he'd made a terrible mistake, because now there was no way out, and it was a really obvious place to hide. They would obviously check this cave out. And so in that moment, he lay down to try to hide himself, and he prayed to the Lord. And he said, "Lord, if you do not do something miraculous, I am going to die here. So I put my faith in you." And as he lay there in that peaceful moment in his exhaustion, he fell asleep. And while he slept, a spider that had been there when he walked in began to make its web, as spiders are wont to do. A bit later, the man awakens and he hears outside the voice of some of the natives, and he hears them speaking to one another in their language. And one of them says, "Here is a cave, we must check it out." And they begin to come into the cave, but one of them stopped the others and said, "Look, there is a spider's web. If he was in this cave, the web would be broken. There is no one here." And they left. I'm here to tell you, my friends, that in the kingdom of God, a spider web can become a fortress. In the kingdom of God, sadness becomes joy. In the kingdom of God, despair becomes hope. In the kingdom of God, fear becomes courage. In the kingdom of God, death becomes resurrection. And we are ushered into eternal life. If we can see Jesus, it's easy to believe. My brothers and sisters, we are standing here on this side of the resurrection. Jesus is here with us today, and I tell you, that seeing is believing, and in Jesus Christ there is always hope for tomorrow. Now, interestingly, there is something that we talk about in our creed this morning that we recited. There is something that we say often to one another, but we don't ponder enough, and that is that Jesus sits with the Father and stands amongst us. And I want you to write that down. He talks about this with the disciples there. He is going to the Father. Jesus is sitting with the Father. And when we say that, what we're really saying is He is seated on the throne of glory. He is seated as ruler of the universe. He is King of kings and Lord of lords. And that is an amazing thing to say about Christ Jesus, our Lord. Jesus sits with the Father, but He stands amongst us. And that means He is here with us. And we can know Him, and we can have relationship with Him. And in knowing Him and in having relationship with Him, that is where our hope is. This is no ghost. This is no desiccated corpse. This is not another episode of The Walking Dead, some kind of zombie here. We're talking about a person who was dead and is now alive. That is who we're talking about, Jesus, who sits with the Father and stands amongst us. Now, several years ago, I found myself at an accident scene. It was a vehicle accident, a terrible wreck. And a carload of college students had been hit head-on by another car. There was one person killed, the person in the other car, and five college students were terribly injured. And I happened to be there very early on, and I was helping package the patients, as the fire department calls it, to load them in the bus or the ambulance for transport. The most injured person was a guy, his name was Mike, and that's really his name. And Mike had a closed head injury. He was badly injured and had a head injury. You could actually see where his skull was broken. You could see the deformity, and he was not conscious. And there's all these injuries, terrible injuries, but Mike was the most injured. And I was helping load him onto a litter and get him ready for transport. And suddenly in the midst of that, Mike opened his eyes, but it was a vacant stare. It was obvious that Mike wasn't really there. But he opened his eyes and he was sitting up and he's struggling, he's combating us in the midst of that. And suddenly I felt the power of the Holy Spirit come on me. Very powerfully, God's Spirit came upon me, and I said, I'm not going to get loud, don't worry, but I said I got my loudest preaching voice, my most commanding voice, and I yelled out, Mike, be calm, lay down, and let us take you where you need to go, son. We're here to help you. I have no idea where all those words came from, but it's what came out of me. And Mike lay back down, and we finished packaging him. We loaded him to the ambulance so that he could get to the hospital where he had to go. In the moments after that, one of his friends was there at the accident scene. She was hurt, but not hurt as bad as Mike. And she handed me a phone and said, here, I just called his parents. Talk to him. In the midst of all that, I have to tell his parents that Mike has been terribly injured. They live a long way away, and they need to get to the hospital, and the outcome is uncertain. Now, Mike, I'd gotten some sort of relationship going here, and I kept up with him. I visited him. A few days later in the hospital, Mike had still not come back to himself. Although he was able to get up and move around and all that, he wasn't there. And one of the things they do with a person who suffered a traumatic brain injury in this sort of instance is they simply get them to do the simple task of everyday life to see if that can help them recover themselves. And so there was a nurse, a therapist who was working with Mike, and Mike was standing at a sink and he was brushing his teeth. And the therapist is standing beside him, and her hand is on his hand, and she's got the toothbrush, and he's brushing his teeth. And suddenly, in the midst of that, Mike's arm locks up rigidly. And the therapist releases his hand and sort of steps back. And with a mouthful of toothpaste, Mike goes, I got this. And he was back. Mike had come back to himself, and he was there. And that was a miraculous moment. There is nothing short of a miracle there. In my living and breathing, I'm here to tell you that was an amazing moment. Jesus sits with the Father, and He stands amongst us. And in that is the miracle-working power of the resurrection. By believing, We have life, and we are sent in His name, having received the Holy Spirit. And I want you to write that down on that last line, those two blanks there. That completes your insert this morning. By believing, we have life and are sent in His name, having received the Spirit. That's what happens to the apostles here. It's what happened at Pentecost. It's what happens as we are gathered here today as Christians in the name of the risen Christ. Now, I'm not just saying, it's not just my opinion. I have these verses here, and I've got a slide. Joshua, if you go to that slide. In verse 21, it says, again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you." There's that phrase. "As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, He breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." And then down in verse 31, this is an editorial comment by John, the writer of this gospel. And John says, these stories, like the one we've just read, are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in His name. So my friends, I'm here today to say that in the name of Jesus Christ, there is always hope, and there is always hope for life tomorrow. Earlier, I mentioned several things that can be transformed through faith in the kingdom of God, through faith in the risen Christ. If we wish to see these things, we must accept the truth of the resurrection. Because when we have life, this abundant life, I just spent 6 weeks preaching on that abundant life. If we have life in His name, we see spider webs becoming fortresses. We see the Spirit of God poured out upon God's people. We see our sons and our daughters prophesy. We see our young with visions and our elders with dreams. We see transformed situations, redeemed lives, and on and on and on and on. There is someone here today who has given up hope on life, and I'm here to tell you there is hope for you in the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. There is someone here who is lonely and feels all alone, and I'm here to tell you you cannot be alone because Jesus Christ is alive with you today. There is someone here who is bereft in grief. There is someone here who is despairing of hope. There is someone here who is in a marriage that feels like it's over, and a job that's going nowhere, and a life that is just ending. And I'm here to tell you today, in the name of Jesus Christ, there is hope for tomorrow. I don't know what it is that brings anxiety into your life. I don't know what it is that worries you, but I'm telling you, there is hope, because seeing is believing. And Jesus Christ always has the final word. And so I say to you today, in the name of the risen Christ, see and believe that there is hope today. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we give thanks to you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us to see and believe that there is hope in Him. And help us to know that in you is the hope of life eternal. For it's in His name we pray. Amen. Now, before we go any further, we're going to have some people join our congregation. And for some of you, you're going to kind of think this is a setup when you see who's joining the church. But I promise you it's not. There's an ancient tradition in the Christian faith for people to join the church or be baptized on Easter. And so today we have three persons who are going to join our church, and they're coming from another Methodist church. And I'm not joining the church because my membership is in the annual conference. So as your pastor, that's where my membership is. But there are three people that I know very well, my son and my daughter and my wife, and they're going to join the congregation today. So if y'all would come forward. And so because they're coming to us from another United Methodist church, really all we have to do is kind of introduce this and then welcome them in the congregation. So y'all stand here and look out there. All right, the church is of God and will be preserved to the end of time for the conduct of worship and the due administration of God's word and sacraments, the maintenance of Christian fellowship and discipline, the edification of believers, and the conversion of the world. All of every age and station stand in need of the means of grace which it alone supplies. For as much as, it's supposed to be a prayer. All right, so let's pray. For as much as all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, our Savior Jesus Christ said, "Unless one is born of water and the Spirit, one cannot enter the kingdom of God." Almighty and everlasting God, we call upon thee for these thy servants, that they, coming to thy holy baptism, may receive remission of their sins and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Receive them, O Lord, as thou hast promised by thy well-beloved Son, and grant that they may be faithful to thee all the days of their lives, and finally come to the eternal kingdom which you have promised through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. All right, Quinn, I'm going to stop and go off script, so good luck with that, all right? You might go forward, you find a blank screen or not. We should have practiced this, I can see now. So all they really have to do is be received into this congregation, and there's a promise that you make to support them as they seek to live out their lives here. So this is Lucy Bingham, my wife, my firstborn and eldest, my son Joshua, and my daughter Margaret. And so they are joining this congregation, and we welcome them. So if y'all want to give them a hand and welcome them. Now, truthfully, they've already been a part here, and you have made us feel very welcome, and I appreciate that, and they do too. And so you don't really have to do anything else because you've been doing it, and y'all have been doing it too. So thank you very much. Now let's stand and sing our closing hymn. Receive now this benediction. Now go out in peace and serve your God and your neighbor in all that you do. And may the blessing of Almighty God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be upon you now and evermore until we meet again. Amen.